Hello again, everybody. This is Dolores Cannon with the Metaphysical Hour again. And tonight we're live. You never know when I'm live and when it's going to be archived. But tonight is live. And I've got a guest, but before we get to the guest, I do want to tell you about the trip. Last weekend, I told you I was leaving the next morning for Moscow. And this was really a whirlwind trip. Oh, before we go any further, let me give you the toll-free number in case anybody wants to call in tonight. We do that before I forget. Toll-free number is 877-876-5227. 877-876-5227. Okay. Because after I did the show last Friday, I had to leave Saturday to go to Moscow, and it was an overnight flight. I got in there on Sunday, talked at the conference on Monday, then flew back on Tuesday. So it was really a whirlwind trip. We wasn't much time over there at all. As I told you, when I was there at the end of August, I did a conference, and they wanted me to come back. And I said, there's no way I can get back that quick. That's too soon. But the Russians can be very persuasive. And this was an international conference on health and healing, and it was mostly focused on doctors because they are really promoting natural healing in Russia, and that's why I'm a part of the whole thing. But when I got there, and I was asking them the Monday morning, I was taking me to the conference, well, what time do I talk? They said, oh, you talk all day. I said, oh, my gosh. Of course, I'm never at a loss for words. I can always find something to say, but I wish they would have let me know ahead of time. So I had to talk all day long on Monday. But one thing I want to say that really hits home, when I got there this time, my translator was not at the airport. My publisher was. And he came up, you know, and everything, but I don't, without her, I found out how totally lost I really am. She's a wonderful young girl, and every time I go over there, she's always right there by me. And this time, it felt so funny when you go in there without a translator. You know, you got to remember, the rest of the Europe and the United States, all the languages are based on the Romance language. In other words, they originated from Latin. We have English, Spanish, French, Italian, German. We all have some kind of a common basis to where in those countries you see signs and things. You will have some indication of what it is, even if you don't know the language. But you go to these Soviet countries and you have the Cyrillic alphabet. There is nothing to give you a single clue as to what the word is. And there's nothing in English anywhere. It's all Russian. And when they're talking, your brain is trying to sort this out to find one familiar word it can grasp onto. And it really gets frantic. I tell them by the end of the day, my brain is mush trying to sort through all of this. It really shows the importance of communication, because by the time I got to the hotel, my translator caught up with us, and I said, boy, am I sure glad to see you, because I was totally lost without my voice there. And it shows the importance of communication. And on the last night, we were having a dinner with the people that brought me over, and the man said, wouldn't it be nice if the entire world just spoke one language? And I said, that would really be good if we could ever work that out and manage it somehow. That would be the ideal. Because when you're over there and you don't have anyone around to speak, like when I was at the hotel, you resort back to body language and hand movements trying to get something across to people when the words don't come through. But it's interesting to do this, but I kept thinking, he's right. If only we could have one language, because it shows how much is lost through miscommunication. How do we really know, even when the leaders are communicating through translators, if it is being translated correctly? There can be so much misunderstanding just with the miscommunication. So, of course, the ideal situation is to do like the ETs do. They all communicate mentally, mind to mind, and that way they say nothing is lost. It's all total honesty because it comes across exact. In my book, The Custodians, they said, we think it's so amusing with you humans, the way you have to communicate. You have all these facial movements and hand movements, and you have all these sounds coming out of your mouth. And they said you have to put one word in front of the next word to make a sentence, to make a paragraph, to make a thought. And they said that it takes so long and it's so complicated. They do it all with just one concept and a thought. Now, that'll be the day when we can get advanced to that point that we can communicate that way. That'd be the way to go, because then there's total honesty. You can't have any deception when it's mind-to-mind and everyone can read the mind. But anyway, this was an interesting trip, and like I said, I was totally surprised when we got to the conference, and they said, oh, you got all day. We'll give you an hour for lunch, but you're going to be speaking all day till 6 o'clock. So it takes longer, too, when you're using a translator. It's slower, back and forth, back and forth. But it turned out it was a really good group of people. Most of them were doctors, and they wanted me to talk so long because we're promoting my classes. And we are setting it up now. We're establishing a schedule for next year. I'll be going back to Moscow several times. I'm going to be working with this academy that is going to be setting up these classes all in Moscow, and then later we're going to spread out all over Russia and into the Baltic states and the former communist countries, because I'm teaching my method of hypnosis, which has to do with the instantaneous healing. And they're very interested in learning this over there. So that was the main reason to go, to meet these people and to set up the new schedule. So I'm going to be going back and forth a lot, I guess. One good thing is since June, we have a direct flight from Chicago to Moscow. And even though it's 10 hours, it's better to do it one trip rather than stop off in London. So this is going to be good that way, because I took the direct flight going over and coming back. So anyway, I'm back now, and it took me a whole day after getting back, all day Wednesday, I was getting over jet lag. So now I guess we're ready to return to normal here anyway. But my guest tonight is Joanne Macko. Now, I've worked with her before, and I've had her on the show before, too. She is in Chicago, and I think you are, Joanne. You live
yes,
in Chicago,
Naperville.
Don't you?
Naperville.
Naperville, that's outside of Chicago. Okay, I don't want to put you in the wrong place. Okay, but one main reason I'm having her on the show tonight is next weekend she's going to be putting on her conference. And I say Chicago, but it's actually in Lyle. That's a suburb, isn't it?
It is, yes.
Okay, and it's called the Lightworkers Midwest Conference. And I'm going to be speaking at it, but I want her to talk about the conference and everything, and you know, who's going to be there and all of this. But Joanne, how many conferences have you done now?
Oh, my gosh. Altogether, about 22.
Wow.
I started on the East Coast and did that for 15 years on the East Coast before I moved here. So
yeah,
it's all that experience and just,
Where were you on the East Coast?
I used to live in Connecticut, in Monroe, Connecticut, and I ran one of the largest fundraisers, and I used to run all types of conferences there for many, many years.
Oh, so you've had a lot of experience of this.
Oh, yeah, we raised millions of dollars for different towns and different causes.
So it wasn't all metaphysics in those days.
No, it wasn't. But all that experience led me to where I am today.
Yeah, so people think it's so easy to put one of these things on. And yeah. Believe me, it's not.
A lot of work.
we're going to have our fourth one in June. And people kept telling me, well, I had my first one. Well, how could you? Couldn't be your first one. But they forget. I've been involved with conferences for 20 years. So we kind of get the hang of it anyway.
Yeah, it becomes second, you know, second nature when you do this every year.
So, you know how it's supposed to be done.
Oh, yeah.
But somebody starting out from scratch, they make a lot of mistakes and have to work a lot of bugs out.
Right. And it really helps when you work both sides of the fence, because I've been the presenter and the vendor and the producer.
Yeah, that way you know all the parts of it.
It really helps.
That's what I've had to do, too, so we do get that background anyway.
Exactly.
But you were in Connecticut, and then you moved to the Chicago area?
Yes, in 1998.
Mm-hmm. That's only been 10 years.
10 years, but boy, we've been busy. It's been a full 10 years.
Well, how many of these conferences have you put on now in Chicago?
Oh, my goodness. I'm going to say about 15, because I've done this many, many times. I just haven't publicized them. You know,
uh-huh.
It was always for small groups, private groups.
Those were the ones that were not metaphysical either then?
They were actually metaphysical, yes.
Okay.
We just didn't go national with it.
I was thinking maybe they were fundraisers again.
And no, those are metaphysical, but we just didn't advertise them nationally.
How long have you been doing the light workers?
This is the fourth year now, and it just keeps picking up steam as it goes along.
You must have started out about the time we did then.
Oh, my God. But I love this. This is my passion. I have so much fun putting this together. You know,
but they are a lot of work. People don't realize out there how much work it is to put these things together.
Yeah.
But this is your fourth one, and I think it's growing, too, every year, isn't it?
Oh, it is, because as the word gets out, I mean, we have so much fun there, as you know. It's just pure joy, and I love who it's attracting, and all ages, not just, you know, older people. It's attracting a younger audience now.
Well, you know, I'm noticing that, too, because, you know, I was, like I said, I was in Europe, you know, the whole month of August, and everywhere I go to conferences, there are a lot of younger people.
Oh, yeah, they're really getting it. These are our future teachers, and these kids are in their late teens. Some of them are, like, even 7 years old that come to our conference. They get it.
Hmm.
They can get up there on the stage, Dolores, and teach us.
Well, I know when I see the younger ones and they're discussing things with us, they don't have the background because they haven't been alive long enough.
Yeah.
So they don't know about the other speakers and their work and all the stuff that's been done for many years.
Exactly.
And it seems funny to have to tell them about this, but that's because they don't have that background. But they're definitely understanding the metaphysical part.
And they understand energy, and they get it. They're very fast learners. They say at 7 years old, your brain absorbs the fastest of any year. You're like a sponge.
Uh-huh.
So it's just fun to have them, to see the kids come in and really sit down and absorb it. Mm-hmm. They really are getting into it and taking the information in. So.
Well, I know I've had the teenagers, you know, asking questions from the audience, and they're intelligent questions.
Exactly.
It's not like it used to be.
Oh, yeah. And the other thing is that children today are not afraid to ask questions, where when we grew up in the 50s, you were always taught, you know, never to ask questions. Everything was just, you took whatever was given to you.
Yeah, that people would laugh at you if you asked a question.
Exactly.
I always tell them, I said, no question is for dumb. Some of them will say, well, I've got a question, but it probably sounds dumb.
Oh, I know. You hear that all the time. I'm like, no, this is what we're here for.
I said, if you've got a question, no question is ever dumb if you want to know the answer.
Exactly. How else are you going to learn?
Uh-huh.
So,
I was taking a drink of water here. But that's the difference. Yeah, they aren't afraid to speak out.
Right.
And I know they're reading my books and, you know, The Convoluted Universe, and even my emails, they are understanding it.
Oh, yes. They totally get it.
These are complicated concepts, too.
Yes. You understand. Sometimes I have to, if I don't understand it, I will ask a younger one. They get it.
just like they know how to use the computers and all these other things, too.
Oh, they're so,
know?
Yeah. We didn't have that working with computers in kindergarten. These kids are starting, you know, right off the bat. It's expected
of them. You know, there's still older people coming to the conferences.
But you know what's interesting? That we have one as young as 7 years old, and the oldest coming this year, I believe, is close to 90.
Wow.
And she's driving from Iowa. Bless her heart.
But so usually the older ones I know have been in this a long time. I don't know if we have many that are switching at that age.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they become too set in what they think and what they believe.
Yeah, it all depends on how they were raised. You know.
Yeah, because, you know, they just get too set in their ways and they're not supposed to start thinking something different.
Sure.
But still, I think metaphysics is growing.
Oh, it is.
I see it everywhere.
The walls are coming down, the veils are being lifted, and people are curious.
Especially where I'm working now with the medical stuff, you know. It's no longer the way it used to be, all the underground. This is becoming more mainstream.
And you know what else I've noticed, Dolores, is when I did these conferences, geez, 10 years ago, there were maybe two or three men in the audience. Now it's 25 to 30% men.
Yeah.
So like, wow, this is great. We are doing a breakthrough.
I know what you mean. I used to be able to count on one hand how many men were at the conferences,
exactly,
the lectures I would give. But even in my classes, I used to say, well, you know, here we have one token male is here, or maybe one or two, you know, but there is more. But in Europe, I have like 50-50 of the male and the female in the classes that I give.
Oh, that's awesome.
So there, I think it's different than it is here.
I think the whole European is, they were always more open.
But even when I'm doing the classes or the lectures and I make a remark like that, you know, well, we just got a few men. The one man said, why is that? He said, the men should be as interested in this as the women. Why is that? So, I don't know, but I think it is changing. And I think it's for the good, too.
It is.
But
I'm thrilled,
world,
and I'm committed to this. You know, I will do this as long as I have the support of people coming.
Well, that's what I'm going to do. I'm caught in it now. There's not any way out of this.
There's no turning back now. It's like our life contract.
But people said, well, you know, when are you going to retire? I said, I wouldn't know what that would be like.
Yeah, what is that word?
Yeah.
I said, I'll be painting in my hundreds.
Well, that's what they have told me. I'll be doing this into my hundreds.
You know, and don't you feel like you're getting younger every year?
I do so much. People keep saying, how can you have the energy to do all these things? But to me, I'd be bored out of my skull if I was sitting there watching TV and, you know, without anything to do at all. I would go nuts, I think.
Exactly. And just intermingling with everybody that comes in from all over the world.
Uh-huh.
There's an energy that takes place in a packed ballroom. Like, you don't get tired. We can go, I could teach or just be there till 3 o'clock every morning and not get tired.
Well, see, that's what happens when I'm doing the lecturing and the classes.
Yeah.
Like when I did that all day just a few days ago in Moscow, and people said, well, aren't you exhausted? I said, no,
there's an
energy off of the audience.
Yes, that collective energy.
And
amazing.
It seems to revitalize you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does.
Well, I think it's the same thing as a performer. You know, the performers on the stage, especially the ones in the music, you know, and the actors on do the plays,
yeah,
they say they get an energy off of the audience, and it keeps them vitalized, you know, and going.
Yeah, and that's why I like to keep mine very high energy. You know, anyone who's been to my conferences, we have a blast. You're not going to fall asleep when Joanie's up there.
Well, that I found after it's over, then you come down.
Oh, I know. It's almost like a letdown because everybody's like going home and they're getting on their planes, and I'm like, oh my gosh.
Well, even the performers, you know, the movie stars and the actors and all that said the same thing. They have that high.
It's like a letdown after.
As soon as the audience is gone, then it all comes down.
Yeah, and then you just start working on the next one. That's all.
That's what revitalizes us anyway, is to be in that energy. And it's a very strong, good energy, too.
It is.
Especially with metaphysics. It seems to be a very positive energy.
And what I love is that the collective energy coming in, especially this year, I'm starting to see something amazing that's happening. People coming to the show now are the movers and shakers of the world. Because I am such an inquisitive person. I'd love to know, who are you? Why are you? What brought you to this conference? And
yeah.
I'm meeting the people coming this year are doctors, heart surgeons, lawyers, big architects, people who have really made a dent in large. They're not afraid to think outside the box.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wow, this is going to be good. And they said, Joanne, you've got to have some kind of networking where, like, what if we're supposed to all work together on some global project? Find out what everyone's gifts are in the audience. So we're going to try some unusual things this year.
Well, see, that's what happens with my clients that are coming to me. They're all walks of life.
Yeah.
And a lot of people think it's just the oddballs and the ding-a-lings, but not.
These are special
people from everywhere.
Yes.
And that's what happened in Moscow, too. They were doctors. They were surgeons. The one that talked to me a lot says he works with the police over there, like a forensics doctor.
Mm.
Another man spent a lot of time with me. They said he's way up in the Russian Orthodox Church.
Oh, my goodness.
And somebody else said, well, they didn't think the church believed in these things. Well, apparently he did. Because he spent a lot of time talking with me. So you never know, who is switching over, I guess you would say, to this.
I've had nuns come to my conferences, but they don't dress in the garb anymore. And I said, Sister,
I have friends that are priests, when they show up.
Oh, my gosh. This one, I said, how do you justify it to the Sister Superior for you coming to these events? She goes, oh, she doesn't know. She thinks it's craft supplies that I'm buying. So they cracked me up. Oh, my God.
That's what the priest said. We just don't wear our collars. And I do work a lot with the ashrams and the swamis.
Oh, yeah.
But this is closer to their beliefs. That's what I found out.
Yeah.
So there's no problem there at all with them.
Mm.
Okay, but let's talk about the conference.
Okay.
I want you to talk about some of the speakers you're going to have this year, what they're going to talk about. Let's spend some time on each one.
Sure. Well, this starts on Friday evening, October 17th, and people start coming in around 5 o'clock, filing in from all over the U.S. In fact, we have 19 states coming in this year and 3 countries, so it's really 4 countries.
Wow.
I'm really excited about that, given the economy and everybody like boo-boo and, oh, my goodness. No, it's like, forget it.
A lot of them say it's going to cost too much to drive,
Oh, well, that the airfares went up, but it's not stopping these people, Dolores.
Yeah.
They are coming. So, to me, this is
going to start on Saturday, what time?
It starts on Friday evening.
Friday evening.
October 17th.
Yeah.
And I welcome everyone at 7 p.m. So, most people start...
7 p.m. on Friday, okay.
Yeah, that's when I welcome everyone. And our first speaker is on around... by the time I make my announcements, the first speaker goes on around 7:20, 7:30. And we have got a winner on Friday night. Oh, my gosh. I just got in the house hours ago because I spent time with him for the last 2 days. He just arrived for his first ever USA appearance. And this is Giovanni Maria Palla from Lecce, Italy. And he has made an amazing discovery about Leonardo da Vinci's artwork, specifically the masterpiece, The Last Supper. Giovanni is a classical musician. And he's married to a trained artist, and they're both historians. And he was studying Leonardo da Vinci for many, many years and passionate about, anyone that knows Leonardo da Vinci, this man was a pure genius.
Oh, yeah.
And he had many, many inventions. And some of those inventions that he did many years ago could work in this day and age right now. But he always said, no one will ever be able to enter my paintings unless they understand how my brain works. Well, this man has broken...
So he used to write backwards, too.
Oh, yes, he was dyslexic.
So he had a strange brain.
Yes, he was totally dyslexic, and he worked with mirrors. So I thought that was interesting. And I stayed up last night till 1 o'clock this morning with Giovanni. I didn't want to go to bed because he was so fat. And he doesn't speak English. So we had to do sign language and everything else.
Did you have a translator or what?
It's amazing. He came here, he did not speak one word of English, but working with him for 3 days, we were able to come up with some, you know, we were able to understand each other. This is what's so interesting. I was teaching him English and he was teaching me Italian. And we did have, Dr. Melisano was...
Like I said earlier, you're bypassing this communication problem.
We are bypassing this. I'm telling you, we had so much fun, but... he gave a presentation, and it was, oh, my gosh, he showed me his slides. And, yes, Leonardo da Vinci was totally dyslexic. And when he would write with a notebook in front of him, he wrote from left to right, from right to left with his left hand, and with his right hand, he would do sketches. Now, that to me is like, I can't even conceive that.
Yeah.
And then what he found was there was a hidden musical song within the painting. So I don't want to give everything away because there's so many layers, and oh my gosh, I'm just, anybody who misses this is going to miss quite an amazing presentation.
Mm.
So, and the beauty thing is he's got experts that back him up, even experts from the Vatican, people that are the specialists in translating Hebrew, which he found hidden within this painting. So he was able to back this up.
I'm really surprised that the Vatican would support him.
There was a Father Luigi Orlando, a specialist in ancient writings. He's one of the tops, and he was. And Giovanni gave him this thing that he found hidden, and he didn't even tell them what he was doing. He says, "All I want you to do is translate this," and it just blew his mind.
Mm.
There was only one person we know of that had a hypothesis about Da Vinci's work, but it was this man, Giovanni Maria Palla, who broke through those ceilings and he found this. So all these countries are after him now to do his book in their language. And I can, yeah, this is major. This is something.
Well, I have heard the theories, you know, about the Last Supper, the painting.
Oh, yeah.
You know, about the one sitting next to Jesus in the painting.
Yes, but nothing could.
Is he going to go into that theory?
Yes, and he did touch on that. He feels it's not Mary, but someone else. And he backs it up with proof. So this is going to be quite an amazing evening.
Okay.
Gosh,
I've heard
don't miss that, anybody.
As I have heard that it was Mary. And Mary Magdalene.
Yes, many people said Mary. Of course, much of this is open to interpretation.
Uh-huh.
But when you see what he produces, you are going to be awestruck. That's all I can say.
Uh-huh. Okay, we don't want to give it away.
I'm not going to give it away because this is going to just blow you away.
Uh-huh. But he's going to have a translator, though, for the conference, isn't he?
Yes, Dr. Rita Melisano is a doctor, a good friend of mine, and she, it turns out, no coincidence, she was born in the same neighborhood, and they came together, so she brought him over here.
Okay, because I was thinking the audience isn't going to be able to connect like you and him were.
Oh, no, they'll be translating, but I'll tell you what, working with him for 3 days, he picks it up immediately, this language.
Uh-huh.
He's a genius. So, who knows? Maybe
so is he just going to talk on Friday, or is he going to talk on the other days?
He will only be speaking on Friday evening from 7:30 to 9:30. And this is his first ever trip to U.S., so I told Dr. Rita, I said, you know, it's a shame he didn't even see downtown Chicago. So she's going to take him and give him the tour. So he will only be with us until Saturday, till about 4 or 5 o'clock.
Oh, well, then if people want to hear him, they're going to have to get there early on Friday, then.
They have to come on Friday.
Okay.
Because he goes back to Italy. He's got a lot of work to do on this. And then what's really exciting, just for this conference, he made special DVDs in English. So this is just for, you know, our performance. So he's got this beautiful set that he put together. He showed it to me. Oh, my God, it's gorgeous. So those will be available.
You're going to be selling those then?
Yes. Giovanni will be selling those when he's there, and then he'll leave them with me when he goes. So I could sell those the rest of the weekend at the conference.
Hmm.
But beautiful presentation he put together, and each one comes with a book, and it's a DVD.
Well, it's a shame he couldn't stay longer.
Oh, I know, but imagine how much work that is for the translator to translate everything that all the other speakers are She would have, oh my gosh, I can't even imagine. She says, Joanne, I wouldn't have a jaw lift if I had to translate the entire show.
Well, imagine my translator had to talk all day.
Oh my gosh,
and
that's a lot of work.
That poor girl.
It is a lot of work. I watched it.
It is, you know, but like I said, they're the voice. Without them, you're totally lost.
Exactly.
They have a very important role to play.
Yes. She certainly does.
So that's going to be a wonderful opening then.
Oh my gosh. This is major, major breakthrough. So this is history in the making. And 5 centuries, oh my goodness. So, and then following him, I have a very last time we get these last minute guests and we just tuck them in there because it's really interesting and it carries that theme. There's someone who also has a radio talk show, Peaceful Planet, on BBS. Marsha McMahon is going to speak for a half hour. And she's going to talk about how many felt they had a past life with Jeshua, which ties in beautifully with what your work does, with your books. You know, Jesus and the Essenes.
Is this going to be on Friday night?
This is still Friday night.
Well, because that's going to go on late then, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. We go till like 11 o'clock at night. And we really have the ballroom till 11:30.
If Giovanni is getting done at 9:30, that would be the end. But you got another speaker after that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Like I said, the energy builds and builds with this show. No, in fact, all the other years I've done this, I had to almost kick people out of the ballroom. They don't want to leave. It's 11 o'clock. I'm like, okay, we got to lock up. They don't want to leave because they're having so much fun.
Yeah.
And then we always end with music. And my son, Bob Macko, is 25, and he's an amazing musician. He's come up with a new album this year. He'll be performing with Sven Oskar Hansen. And I've got a special guest musician coming in. Oh, my goodness. John Galloway. Just amazing musician. I met him at a World Peace Conference in Yellowstone National Park over the summer solstice. And I have never heard a voice like this. He really belongs on the stage with the big boys. He's agreed to come in as a special presentation. Like I said, I feel like the little kid before Christmas.
And that's still Friday night.
This is all Friday. We're only on Friday.
Okay, that's what I was thinking. You're having all that music on Friday, too, you know?
Oh, yeah, this is a jam-packed weekend, but it is going to be good.
Well, I have met Julia Hansen, you know, and she spoke at my conference, too.
Oh, yeah.
And we're going to be publishing her book, so I do know her.
Yes, and she's coming in from Austin, so she wants to hear all the speakers, and I'll get to see her.
Okay. All right. Now, is that all on Friday?
That's Friday.
Conference right there on Friday.
It sounds like the whole weekend, doesn't it?
Okay. Now, then what happens on, is that all of Friday?
That's Friday.
And what happens on Saturday then?
And then Saturday, we open the ballroom doors at 9 a.m., and then you are the first speaker. You are our keynote for the weekend.
Okay.
So you'll be
In the morning then.
Yes, you start at 9:30, and you'll take us to lunch. So if you go till 11:30, then we'll have time for questions and answers, and they could, you know, buy some of your books. And then lunch is always at noon.
What am I going to talk about? I never know until I get there.
I know. This is the best part, Dolores, because you are just so chock full of information. We can't just have one subject.
I usually say, what do you want? You know, I can focus on anything you want.
You always talk about the whole enchilada. There's so many books that you've written, my goodness, you know, and you always have new information because of all your travels. I could listen to you for the whole weekend and never even touch the tip of the iceberg. So
like,
we figured
I didn't even touch it on that whole day over there.
I know. So I'm never worried about how to fill time with your slot.
What do you want me to talk about that morning?
Oh, my goodness. Any new information that you have, you know, from the convoluted universe books?
Okay, because they have come out since the last time I spoke there. The new one has come out.
Okay.
And it's got information in it, and I'm still getting information.
Right.
So I guess that's going to be in the morning then.
That will be from 9:30, and you'll take us right to lunch.
Oh, okay.
So there's plenty of time from 9:30, 10:30, 11:30, and then we even give you an extra half hour for questions, you know, for purchasing books. And you know that audience, just they could ask you questions. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, yeah, but, you know, I always expect that. And that's the good part. You never know what their questions are going to be.
Exactly. And the audience just loves you. I you get the highest ratings every year, and they, oh, my gosh, bring her back, bring her back. So we just love you here in Chicago. We're just honored that you're coming back, especially with your busy schedule.
Who's going to follow after lunch then?
And then following lunch, we have a brand new speaker coming in from California. He's a best-selling author, Jean-Claude Gerard Coven. He wrote Going Deeper. And he's just one of these delightful characters that lights up a room when he walks in. And he's going to be taking the audience on an experiential trip to show them a different way of looking at life. And he does everything with his sense of humor. So he's a nice, refreshing, so he's fun.
It'll be kind of like a workshop where they go into trance or what?
Yeah, I've never listened to him talk. He just did a 6-7 page interview here in Chicago that I arranged for, and I was reading his interview, and it's just fascinating. But he's had trips, he travels all over the world, too. Like, he just came back from Bali, he was in Peru, and he's going to talk about many different things, but he said he's going to take the audience on an experiential trip if they're ready to go, to kind of unleash different
things. You're
going to
leave it that way as suspense, then.
Oh, yeah. And then following John,
see where they're going to go. Then.
Oh yeah, you'll just have to come and see, right?
Yeah, then they'll be surprised. They won't know where he's going to take them.
You might learn something about yourself that you never knew.
Okay. Sounds interesting.
Oh yeah. And then following Jean-Claude, Dr. Meg Blackburn-Losey. She's just grown so fast. She's speaking all over the world now and taking people on spiritual tours. And she just signed up with, she just moved to Hollywood. So that's like major news. So I wouldn't be surprised if she has her own show. But she's going to talk about getting real and talking about what's happening with the light workers now. You know, what do you foresee with this, you know, this next change, this next evolution? And this is going to be interesting because she'll talk about how a lot of light workers are getting hit upside the head. They're getting flipped upside down. It's almost like going through the eye of a needle. And if you have all this baggage with you, that's not going to fit through that eye of a needle. And that's what we're finding because, like, I love talking to these people, you know, throughout the
years. Well, I'm getting that with a lot of my clients. You know, they're all going major things right now.
Oh, my gosh. Have you noticed how many are just getting flipped upside down? And they can't handle this new vibration. They're not letting go of their baggage.
Yeah, that's when I tell them, you got to get rid of the baggage and the garbage because
that
makes them sick. And the time now is to get rid of all this stuff that's holding them back.
Exactly. If you don't heal this, how are you possibly going to go into the next relationship?
Mm-hmm.
All you're going to do is attract the same thing.
You can't go to the new earth carrying all this junk around with you.
Exactly.
So there's a lot of people feeling very definite changes right now.
Oh, yeah, and then with the whole economy thing, it's like there are people that are, and these are light workers, they're in fear. And I'm like, this is why I'm passionate about doing this conference. You have got to walk the talk now. You can't teach something and turn around and do something.
Because that's one of the main things that I've been speaking about. You have to let go of fear.
Yes.
The fear and the karma, but the fear especially.
Fear.
And I was noticing, even on CNN last night, they were talking, you know, they were there at the stock market, and they kept saying, we can't have fear. Fear is your greatest enemy, and it will hold us back. You don't need fear right now, and that's what I'm telling everybody.
Exactly.
But they said, fear is destructive. Well, it is. You get caught up in that, and it can, it is a very, very strong emotion.
Right.
And
it's a collective energy.
This is just the testing times.
Is it? So people like us, the spiritual leaders, we have got to stand up and say, look, you know, knock it off. Can you imagine if I went into fear over this conference? Like, oh, my God, what if nobody shows? It would all collapse. I just don't go there. I know this conference is going to be filled every year, and I feel it. You put an emotion behind it, and I'm telling you,
it takes on a life of its own.
It does. It does.
You know, it becomes alive, and that means it can go out there and do its own thing.
Right. And I think the people that want to stay in fear, fine, stay home. Don't bring that energy here.
Oh, yeah, I definitely
this is
like
going on come hell or high water. And we're going to have a blast.
I don't want negative energy.
No.
Positive energy just builds on itself, and it can really be overwhelming. It's
right.
Good. It's really good.
That's why I won't let any fear teachings at this conference or any group that feels they're the only group out there, you know.
Yeah, the ones that say only what we believe.
Yes.
That's the only truth.
Exactly.
Because
go
the
there.
Truth is, it's all in the way that people perceive it, and it comes in many different forms.
Exactly. Everyone has their own truth.
Yeah. Your truth may not be my truth, but at least it's something you believe, and you're entitled to it. You know?
Exactly. But I'm about moving people forward and keeping them positive and shored up and showing them how magnificent they truly are. You just forgot.
Oh, we get so many emails now with people, they are living in fear, and we try to, you know, to talk them out of that, and especially when I have my clients. It's up to you whether you want to live in fear or if you want to live positive, because you have control over your life either way.
Isn't that a shame, though? They live like almost in prison.
It definitely is a prison. Yes,
a prison.
The fear definitely is.
Yeah. And life's too short.
It's making a pick, too, in the long run. You know?
Right. Life is way too short.
But this is all on Saturday. Now, who else?
And there's more on Saturday.
I was thinking there's some more because
that's
all day on Saturday.
This is a long day, but it's a fun day. Adela Dorothy Toy comes in after dinner on Saturday, and she's talking about traveling between the worlds.
Okay.
And she's a fascinating character. She happens to be the secretary of the Board of Trustees of the American Society of Dowsers.
Oh, yes. I work a lot with the Dowsers.
Aren't they amazing?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
I've been working with them for many years. Harold McCoy, who has the Ozark Research Institute, he teaches healing.
Yeah.
By remote viewing healing. He was the international head of the Dowsers for a long time.
Oh, was he?
So I'm very much familiar with the Dowsers.
I used to. That was one of my first shows that I went to when I moved here was the Midwest Dowsers Convention.
Yeah, I've
no longer there.
Years and years ago.
That's going way back.
So they're good people.
They're very good people. So
she's
going to be fun, and she has her own shop, and she's a fascinating woman. And then following her is Trish Poole. I believe Trish worked with you. She's a certified hypnotherapist.
I think she took one of my classes.
Yeah, she did. And she'll be Discovering Your Angel Essence is her title. So she'll take the audience on an experiential, it's like a little mini workshop.
Okay, you're going to have two then on the same day.
Yeah.
That are going to take the audience on a little trip.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And discover yourself. And then we end the last speaker for Saturday night is Judy Lynn Cole and her partner Tom Myers. And she is, the title there's a secret, sacred, sonic science. That's a mouthful. But she is a sound expert, and she travels all over the world, and she has studied sound, sonic codes, and she will talk about, she gets into scalar waves, and she gets into some pretty deep stuff. But
well, I know Sherry Edwards. I don't know if she's associated with her, or she... She probably knows of her work.
I'm sure they all know each other. Yeah.
Yeah, Sherry Edwards was the pioneer on sound and how the sound affects the body. And we all have a tone and all of that, So she does the same idea or what?
Yes, she dissects things. I mean, she's got a brain that just never stops. But she is actually going to take one of my paintings, one of my portal paintings, and actually show how there's sound waves within a painting.
Oh.
Why are you attracted to a certain painting? Why does a certain painting call to you? It opens up your heart. And there's actually sound coming off of that, and she's going to show that, among other things.
Well, I've been, in my work, they've told me color has sound.
Oh, yes.
We always
does.
Think of the other way around, as one is being seeing and one is being hearing, but it can be both ways and opposite.
Oh, exactly.
So the color... Is she meaning the color in the painting or just part of the painting?
She's actually saying there are sound waves within paintings. So she's going to show that, and she's going to bring a certain oscillator with her, and actually, so that's going to be really interesting.
Okay, because people have told me there's energy in books also.
Oh, yes.
Much more than, they said there's much more in there than I think there is when I write a book, that there's something else between the lines.
Yes.
So everything creates an energy you're not even aware of.
Oh, everything has an energy. So,
but it's not the energy we think is there. That's part of the exploring and the discovery is the good part.
Yeah, and I guess that answers, well, it brings up a question. Why are you attracted to a certain book? Why are you attracted to a certain painting or an image?
Yeah. There's
something there. So this is that's going to be an interesting talk
okay.
as well. And then, again, we'll probably end with music, and we want to make sure people have fun to network, you know, mingle. There's going to be some vendors there for shopping. So that's a full day, but a fun day.
And both, you do leave time for people to eat in there, don't you?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We break for an hour and a half for dinner and an hour and a half for lunch.
Okay.
So, not to worry. You're not going to starve. Everybody gets to eat.
That's what I'm thinking. You know, you can only go so long.
Oh, I know. We always make sure we have
room. What's Sunday now? What's on Sunday?
Sunday, again, the doors open at 9, and then you're the first. Again, it's a... Dolores Cannon, you are going to speak between 9:30 and take us up to lunch again.
Okay,
so
what about, I like to have an inkling before I get there.
Oh, I know. Well, we've like I said, with all your travels, the audience would probably love to hear what's happening, you know, your latest trips. And then there's so many books you wrote. My gosh, the Jesus and the Essenes is always brought up.
Uh-huh.
People love that book.
Oh, yes.
Whenever
yes.
I mention Dolores Cannon, they, oh, my God, oh, she's the one that taught Jesus in the Essenes, or, you know, that wrote that. And
see, that's my books are in 20 different languages now.
Oh,
that's one of the reasons I travel so
it's
much.
Amazing.
But that book is also in Russian.
Is it?
Yeah, that's
oh,
one
God.
Of them. I have two publishers over there now, and they're going to they're translating all of my 15 books anyway.
Wow.
But, yeah, they're very interested in the Jesus books.
And the other thing I'm noticing with this audience coming in this year, whenever I ask them, you know, about themselves, they all said, you know, I don't know why I'm being drawn to this conference, but I knew that I had a past life with Yeshua. So I'm like, isn't this getting interesting? So I think it would be great if you touched on that book, Jesus and the Essenes, or any of the works. That...
Whatever you want me to talk about, I'll talk about.
You realize that's what attracted me to you in the first place in 1994 when I met you.
Way back.
It was in Orlando, Florida. It was called the Millennium Conference. Raymond Moody was there. Brian Weiss was there. All the big names.
Yeah, that was a long time ago.
That's
yeah.
when I met you, Dolores. In fact, I found a picture of you and me together from 94. When I was cleaning up just last week, I was laughing here. That's, oh, my gosh. Because at the time, I didn't know who you were, and I went to hear all these other names, and all I saw was Jesus and the Essenes, and I thought, oh, my gosh, I have to be at this conference. I have to be at this talk. And I sat down, and you had an overhead slide projector and with the transparencies, and I sat there with my mouth open. I'm like, please just keep talking. Just don't let this end. Because you taught everything that one of your clients remembered in that past life. Oh, my gosh. To me, I love that material. That's my favorite, my personal favorite.
Well, I didn't think about it, but I guess I could bring those transparencies again. I didn't even think about it. I'm used to just sitting there talking now, you know, going into so many different subjects.
You wouldn't even have to show those slides, just listening to the information that you garnered from these people, because you are that investigator of lost knowledge. I mean, I could just listen to that forever.
And it's still pouring out of people. I'm still finding more.
Yes. Yes, so many of them knew they... So, yeah, this is interesting, and I think many of the women
know where I don't know where it's going next because there's so much it keeps coming.
Right. But I love spontaneity. I mean, these people were just, because you've covered so many topics. There's some people that want to talk about crop circles because there's so many new ones that have popped up.
Yeah, and a lot of people want to talk about my book on life after death.
Oh, that's always a fascinating subject.
Yeah, because even in Russia, that's in Russian, too. And
oh,
they're
wow.
interested in that topic, too.
Yeah.
You know, where you die and everything.
You don't have to worry about boring your audience, that's for sure.
Well, I usually want to figure, what is the person putting it on, what they want me to talk about?
Oh, you know, whatever you talk about. But that's my favorite subject. And I know they wanted last year, I don't think we even got into the crop circles. And,
I've talked about them because I've been an investigator.
Okay.
Since 92, you know, and I know all the people that are involved in that, too.
Yeah.
So there's just a wealth of information anyway.
And you've done fabulous work in that area in England. So, oh my gosh, that would be awesome if you could even.
Well, who follows me after lunch then on Sunday?
Meg Blackburn comes back, and she's going to do a live channeling, which everybody loved last year. She goes into that trance state, and then while she's in that state, people get to ask her questions.
Oh, okay.
And you never know what's going to come through with those live channels, so.
Oh, yeah, because channeling is not rehearsed. You never know.
Exactly. So, yeah, so we've just got some, and I always leave room for surprises, so.
Uh-huh.
And well, then we usually.
Is the channel a male or a female entity?
You know, I don't know. It may be a group because many people bring
a group.
In groups.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
And then the audience will be able to ask questions.
Exactly. And then I know I talk on Sunday afternoon as well because I'd like to. There's so many things that have happened. I've been involved with huge global projects this past year. Unity for Threads, where I collected threads from all these different countries and incorporated into one painting. And, oh, my God, the stories just behind that, oh, my gosh, amazing.
Yeah, that's one thing we want to tell the audience is that you are an artist and you're well-known for your paintings.
Yeah, they've reached worldwide now, and many world leaders have collected them. So,
I'm trying to think. Mostly you focus on angel paintings, don't you? Or is it
mostly on angels, but I've gotten into a whole new line, too, these very abstract portals.
Portals, yeah. Okay.
Portals, yeah. And now this last one, this global unity project, just fascinating. So I'd love to share what happened with that and how I met with many of the indigenous tribal leaders at a big conference in Yellowstone. I met, and some of the information they gave us. One of the top Mayan leaders was there, Don Alejandro, and what he taught us about Atlantis and how much of what we have been teaching about their culture is wrong. So, we have so much to share. We need a week on this, Dolores. That's what we need. There's never enough time.
That's the way to do it. You go direct to the horse's mouth.
Exactly. And boy, did we get the information twisted on their culture. So we're going to share
some other people,
that.
They get their information secondhand. There's a lot of people out there in this field, speakers and all of that I call the users.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody else said they're the hunters and the gatherers.
Exactly.
And we don't like them, but they exist. They use everybody else's material.
Right.
And they have nothing new of their own.
Exactly. And, yes.
And, unfortunately, we do the work, but they're always just put it together and present it as their own.
Right.
Well, what goes around comes around. Karma, you can't get away from it.
I say that all the time, karma.
Oh, yeah.
But I'd rather get it straight from the horse's mouth. And he is the oldest.
Yeah, I always want to make sure, that the information I have is accurate. And I go to where, I do tons of research. So you're the same way. You have the same curiosity.
Yes.
And you want to know. I want to know everything.
I want to go right to the horse's mouth.
Yeah.
He is the oldest elder with 400 elders underneath him.
Where it's really coming from.
And he's in his 80s. He says, I don't have long to be here on this planet. So
we got to do what we can.
Yes.
Okay, we're coming around to time. Can you believe we talked?
Oh, my gosh. Yes.
Yeah.
It's always so much fun.
Who else after you? Are you the last one?
We'll probably have some surprises in the end. I always save room for surprises, and then we always end it with a big healing circle. And then we also have a world-class healer coming in from Philippines, Leonie Romero. So lots of things.
Now, tell everybody how they can find out about this.
They can go to, we have a dedicated website now called lightworkersconference.com, and everything you need to know is in there. You can safely and securely register there. My phone number's in there, my email.
Well, give out the website again.
It's lightworkers, that's plural, lightworkersconference.com.
It's all together.
It's all together.
lightworkersconference.com.
Yes, and all the speakers are in there, photographs, all their links to their sites, the schedule's in there.
And they can find out the prices
everything's
and times and everything.
Everything's there.
It's going to be at a hotel there in Lisle, isn't it?
Yes, this is the Wyndham Lisle Hotel. It's on Warrenville Road in Lisle, Illinois, just conveniently located close to O'Hare, about a half hour from O'Hare.
Okay. So anybody who's interested, this sounds like it's really going to be an interesting conference. Okay, so we're coming up to the time. If I don't stop on time, they always pull the plug. But the time passes so quickly, especially if we get an interesting guest like yourself.
Oh, thank you.
All right, well, I'll see you next week then.
Okay, thank you, Dolores.
That means I won't be doing a live show next Friday because I'll be on the plane and I'll be at Joanne's conference. So they'll be doing a show out of the archives. So I'll see you next weekend, Joanne.
Okay, thank
and
you.
And let's, we're coming down to the wire. Everything goes well.
Safe travels.
All right.
Bye-bye.
So good night, everybody.
If you enjoyed the show, check out more of our other videos and be sure to subscribe and click the like button. Thank you for listening to the Metaphysical Hour with Dolores Cannon.